بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. This is part 10 from the series on the rejectionist Shia. And this is still focusing concerning the myth spread in their sources concerning the Quran that there is distortion and omission and so forth. The question in this talk is, do the Shia, the rejectionists, have a Mus'haf a copy of the Quran, a copy which compiles all these missing and or distorted verses . Do they have a copy comprising these claimed distortions, which they may recite in as a, instead of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There are many texts, rejectionist Shia texts, which command them to act according to the Quran until their Mus'haf emerges with their awaited Imam. This is reported, for example, in the Kafi of Al-Killini. Usul al-Kafi, volume 2, page 619. And they attribute that this is a promise from some of their imams, like in the report from Al-Killini's Kafi, that this promise was during the reign of their imam Abul Hasan, as they claim. So in that report attributed to him, he commands them to recite, meaning in the Quran known to us, and as you know it, for there will come someone who will teach you, and this one who will teach you did not come generations after generations. And they interpreted the shiyukh of the Shia interpreted this to mean, this teacher to mean al-Mahdi, their Mahdi, their awaited Mahdi, as in al-Mazandarani's Sharh Jami'in ala al-Kafi, volume 11, page 47. And there are many texts for the Rafida pointing that this refers to their awaited Mahdi. Also their Mufid, al-Mufid, reported that they are commanded to recite what's in the copies of the Quran we have, and that we should not go beyond that without omission nor deletion until حتى يقوم القائم عليه السلام, until القائم meaning the Mahdi will come, and then فيقرأ الناس القرآن على ما أنزله الله تعالى وجمعه أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام. So then people will recite the Quran as revealed by Allah and as collected by أمير المؤمنين meaning علي عليه السلام, as they said. بحار الأنوار, volume 92, page 74. And also their Sheikh Ni'matullah al-Jazairi reported that in their narrations the Imams commanded their Shia to recite this existing Quran in the Salah and in other than the Salah, and to act in according with its rules until there emerges Mawlana Sahib al-Zaman, the man of time, meaning the Mahdi, their Mahdi, and that this Quran, فَيَرْتَفِعُ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ, and this Quran will be lifted from the hands of people to heavens, and then will come وَيَخْرُجُ الْقُرْآنِ الَّذِي أَلَّفَهُ أَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فَيُقْرَأْ وَيُعْمَلُ بِأَحْكَامِهِ, and then will come the Quran which أمير المؤمنين collected, put together, and it will be recited, and people will act according to its rulings. This is in Ni'matullah al-Jazairi's, their famous man of knowledge, in his book Al-Anwar al-Nu'maniyya, volume 2, pages 363-364. But this is contradicting, as you will see. Many reports, we passed over some of them during the previous talks, assert according to them that the Quran that we have now is what? Is distorted. And these other reports now, ordering and attributing this to their imams, ordering to recite from this existing Quran, and yet it is what? It is distorted in according to the other narrations. You see the discrepancy and the contradiction? Can you see now? Not only that, these texts which call to act upon the Quran are opposed yet by other texts which in a deceptive way, not explicit, calls for abandoning the Quran because it is changed in their accounts, and not to give it much attention to memorize. And that anyone who memorizes it while it is distorted will have difficulty to memorize what will come from their Mahdi, as reported in the Mufid Irshad, page 430. This narration is for their Mufid. Who is the Mufid? They consider him holy. and magnify him. They even considered him to the level that he was beyond the level of humans. Why? Because they said, listen, they said that their awaited Imam addressed him by the name Al-Akh Al-Sadid, the upright brother, and Al-Mawla Al-Rashid. This is written in the introduction in the book of Al-Ihtijaj, page 277. Similarly reported by An-Nu'mani in his book Al-Ghaiba. Such myths and calls to not to give this Quran the attention it deserves had its impact upon the Shia societies, as attested to by a Sheikh Musa Jarallah, who lived amongst the Shia for some time, and he didn't find from the Shia students nor from their scholars who memorized the Quran. Not even to be able to recite it properly. And he concluded that this could be from the influence of the myth concerning waiting for the Mahdi's Mus'haf, which is absent now in the hands of the one who is entrusted concerning the household of the Prophet's family and the Imams, meaning the Mahdi. Contradictions upon contradictions. You may examine some of the reliable books of the Shia to them, and you may find some narrations therein spread calling for reciting this Quran. But these cannot be harmonized nor reconciled with the famous and replete narrations in the same books which considers the Quran distorted, and that the true Quran is still in the hands of the Mahdi awaited for. Another thing. What is also replete in the words of their Shuyukh is the existence of a Mus'haf particular with Ali, and that they are not in disagreement regarding this. Even those from amongst them who deny the distortion in the Quran believe in the existence of a Mus'haf with Ali, like Ibn Babawayh al-Qummi, as in his book Al-I'tiqadat, and Al-Khu'i from the latter ones in Iraq in his Bayan, page 223. So they had said that in this Mus'haf of Ali is, now the question is, what is in this Mus'haf of Ali, quote unquote? Are there additional verses or just interpretations. This claimed Mus'haf of Ali was mentioned in the very early books of the Shia. And they claim in many references that it contains additional things to the known Quran. And one of their men, Al-Killini, they are trustworthy upon the deen, they call him. In his book Al-Kafi, he had a special chapter. He said, بَابٌ أَنَّهُ لَمْ يَجْمَعَ الْقُرْآنَ كُلَّهُ إِلَّا الْأَئِمَّ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّلَامُ, that the entire Quran was not compiled totally except by the Imams. And he reported 6 narrations to their Imams. Some, they say, they are Imams. Some, and most, say with Ali. So if Ali entirely compiled it, so what is the need for having others after him compiling from the other Imams? Unless they believe that they shared with Ali, yet they were not present yet. That's the only explanation. And also, other conflicting reports claiming some of their specials were able to see this Mus'haf of Ali, and other reports still claim that no, this was very particular, no one was supposed to see it. So these narrations speak of a secret copy. And that in it, according to some who were able to see some of it from their quote specials, there are subjects making takfir of the Sahaba, if I continue with you and tell you some of the other narrations, you will be amazed. Yes. They claim that this Mus'haf, now not with Ali, they claim it is with the awaited Mahdi. And that this is replete. So some reports claim that some special had seen it. Other reports say, yes, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu compiled it. Other reports say Ali and the other Imams. And other reports say, yes, it is Ali, but it is where? It is with the awaited Imam. As Ni'matullah al-Jazairi claimed in his Al-Anwar al-Nu'maniyya, volume 2, page 360. There is no doubt that Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu is free and innocent from this myth, and that he did not recite nor did he rule except in the Mus'haf which the companions were all agreed upon. Some of the books of the Shia even attest to this fact. Attest to the same report which came in Sunan Abi Dawood from Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, where Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, لا تقولوا في عثمان إلا خيرا, don't say anything about عثمان except that which is good. فوالله ما فعل في المصاحف إلا عن ملأ منا, by Allah, he didn't do in compiling the Mus'haf in one except we are all in agreement and support with him, of him. This same report was referred to by some books of the Shia. They referred to the words of Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This is in Sunan Abi Dawood with authentic narration from the report of Suwaid bin Ghafla. Even they, in some of these books who related the same saying of Uthman, still they had said what? Claimed that when Uthman saw the problem of having more than one cup is spread in the hands of people, he asked Ali to bring the Mus'haf of Fatima, which she kept due to her father's Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's approval, and that Uthman compared it with the Masahif in the hands of the other companions. So therefore, what is the point from their report? The point from their report is that the Masahif which we have in our hands is the Mus'haf of Fatima, not the Mus'haf of Uthman. You see that? You see, even though they related the saying of Ali that what Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu did was right, but they are now hinting in this report, in this report, in some of their books, but otherwise you have heard the disagreements and the opposing narrations which we mentioned earlier. They hint that Uthman only was a publisher, not more. As in Al-Mar'ashi's Al-Ma'arif Al-Jaliyah, page 27. Contradictions upon contradictions. Nevertheless, if this report indicates anything, this puts them in another contradiction. You know what it is? You see, you heard their report that Uthman compared the Mus'haf of Fatima, which they claim, with what? With the rest of the Sahabas, right? Right? This puts them in another contradiction. What is the other contradiction? That this noble Quran which reached us from the way of Abi Bakr and Uthman and his brothers, what? They are the ones who have, who have the greatest share of cursing in the books of the Shia. Isn't this the greatest contradiction? Because Uthman took the copies from the Sahaba and Abu Bakr and Umar from them, isn't it? So this puts them in another contradiction. If you claim as such, but you curse Abu Bakr and you curse Umar, then you know what? This is another contradiction. Because in this way, you are insulting the Quran, which spoke of the merit of the companions. And from them, Abu Bakr. Right? You see this point? You see this delicate point which puts them in this... This is what? This is concerning the few reports which mention that Ali approved of what Uthman did. this myth about this other Mus'haf, these distortions, these additions and so forth, are replete in the books of the Shia. And that all started from two narrations in the book of Sulaym bin Qais, which we talked about in part 9. And the major Sheikh of the Rafida who spread this in his books is Ali bin Ibrahim al-Qummi. And from them is their Sheikh al-Mufid, whom they label him as Ruknul Islam, the pillar of Islam. And they call him Ayatullah al-Malik al-Allam, who died 1413 after Hijrah. He attests that this is replete amongst the sect of the 12 Imamites. As in his book Awa'il al-Maqalat, page 98. This is the quote fruit of fabrications and attributing this to the household of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Had the household of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, had they possessed something of what these people are talking about, they would have brought it to mankind. And they wouldn't have the slightest right of keeping it to themselves. But even with the testimony of some of the Shia, the household of the Prophet ﷺ did not recite except in the Book of Allah. And during the most explicit of their shuyukh, in spreading this disbelief statements, are the shuyukh of the Safwid state of the Shia rejections. In the 11th century. And even their Sheikh of this Safwiyya state of the Rafida, their Sheikh Abu al-Hasan al-Sharif, and he is one of the students of their other Sheikh known as al-Majlisi, they said يمكن الحكم بكونه من ضروريات مذهب التشيع. He said it is possible to rule that this, meaning this myth of distortion, is from the necessities of the Shia sect, end of quote. Mir'atul Anwar, page 49. And their trustworthy Mazandarani, who died in 1081 after Hijrah, he stated that this is consecutive in their books, as in Sharh al-Jami' ala al-Kafi, volume 11, 76. Similarly by al-Kashani. And their reference in Iraq, Al-Khu'i, Al-Khu'i, the reference of the Shia in Iraq, contemporary, and others nowadays, they say that the narrations are replete, meaning the narrations which attribute to their imams, concerning this myth of changes in the Quran, through the household are consecutive and decisive. This is darkness upon darkness. Question. Does all the Shia believe in the authenticity of these narrations and in their consecutiveness? The answer is most of the Shia references and most of the most reliable references had fell into this darkness, and we spoke about that in the past talks. Not only that, their Sheikh Al-Mufid, who died 413, claims that this is consensus amongst their Imamite sect. And he did not mention that there was opposing reports in some of their scholars against this. Like Ibn Babawayh Al-Qummi, who died 381. And by Al-Sharif Al-Murtada, who died 436, and by At-Tusi, who died 450, and by At-Tabrasi, who died 548 or 561. These are four. The fourth is Ahmad At-Tabrasi. Should not be confused with An-Nuri At-Tabrasi. An-Nuri At-Tabrasi is with the opinion that this is the consensus of the Shia, that this myth is the consensus of the Shia. Now, so these four, how they were dealt with by the rest of the majority of the Shia or rejectionists, Shiuch. Let's take first one, Ibn Babawayh. Ibn Babawayh, in some of his books, denounced this myth and said that the Quran, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which exists between the two cover pages present in the hands of people, is the true Quran. The other Shia Shiuch claimed that Ibn Babawayh was resorting to taqiyya, concealment, because of the impact of this myth upon the common Muslims. Lest the common Muslims will believe that this sect of the Shia is an astray, and it will harm the sect. Now the question is, the strange thing is that in Ibn Babawayh's other books you find narrations indicating the same myth. So So this is Ibn Babawi. The same holds true with the other three. The other three denounced as Ibn Babawi. But the strange thing is that there are reports in some of their books approving or in support of this myth. So, is there struggle amongst these people? Is there conflict? Or is it part of the concealment? Many of the scholars of Ahl Sunnah are on the opinion that this is due to concealment. And also, many from the so-called reliable shuyukh of the Shia, who related even consensus on this myth. In conclusion now regarding this matter, first, it is possible that this myth began with the Shia, the rejectionists, in the 2nd century. And we named some of their books. And from the reasons was the lack of mention in the Quran of anything about their Imamites and of their falsehoods regarding the companions. Secondly, most of the reliable books of the Shia attest to this myth and reported this myth and came explicit to the extent which is clear that there is no metaphorism or misinterpretation. They even went, as we discussed earlier, that they said this verse speaks of this companion and this refers to Ali and this is against this and so forth. We gave many examples on that. Thirdly, many of their shuyukh declared that these myths are replete in their reliable books. And you know what is the conclusion here? The conclusion here that this constitutes that their books are not reliable. Because their books insult the book of Allah. And this may explain, in addition to the matter of concealment, this may explain some of the denunciations which we heard by their four scholars which we named. Finally, this myth contains in it or in itself a refute for its validity. In the process of its formulation, there was the destruction of it. Mere presenting of it is sufficient as a refutation. Sufficient in proving the lies of the Rafida is that Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu whom to most of them is like God, Allah, Creator. And with some, or to some, he is a spoken prophet. And with many is their infallible imam. He remained 5 years and 9 months as a khalifa, as a ruler, while the Quran recited in the masajid everywhere and leading the people in the prayer and the masahif with him and in his hands. Had he seen in it a distortion, as the Rafida claim, would he approve of that? And would his offspring after him approve of that? He stood to fight those who denounced because of their mistake of not yielding to his khilafah, who found that not to follow him in his khilafah. He fought them. Would he then not fight those who alter the Quran and change the Islam? This is assuming that those who disagreed with Ali disagreed with him regarding the Khilafah, while in reality we know that it was not the issue of the Khilafah, it was the issue of giving priority to handle those who killed Uthman. Nevertheless, for the sake of argument, would he then not make jihad against those who, quote, may have changed the Quran? So from this it appears very clear the falsehood of this claim of the Rafida. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. In the next part, inshallah ta'ala, we will talk about the rejectionists and the sunnah. The rejectionists and the sunnah. والله أسأل والله أسأل سبحانه وتعالى to give us the clarity on these matters and to make them a benefit for myself and for all of those who come to know of them and listen to them. إنه ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful, I testify that there is no true God worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is Allah's true slave and messenger. We continue the series of discussions on the rejectionist Shia, and this is part number 11 And this will focus, this will be the beginning of focusing upon their creed and their position with respect to the Sunnah. As we have learned with respect to their position regarding the Quran, we learned that they resort to esoteric or batini interpretations of the texts. So, what will or what is the position of the rejectionist, the Rafida, with respect to the Sunnah? The Sunnah to them is all that which originates from the infallible, from sayings or actions or approvals.